In one of our other videos, my Jamestown Rediscovery colleague, Sean Romo, spoke a little bit about the process that we use when writing our technical reports on the excavation work that we do at Jamestown. In this video, I'd like to talk a little bit about one of the reports that I have been working on while we've been sheltering in place at home during these last couple of weeks. My name is Mary Anna Richardson Hartley, and I am a senior staff archaeologist with Jamestown Rediscovery Foundation, and I'm speaking to you today from my home office, as you can see, for this episode of Dig Deeper. Team has been working from home the last few weeks, some of us have been working on the technical reports. I've mainly been focused on our work inside the Memorial Church. This project took place from 2016 until 2019, when we found the west wall of the 1617 timber frame church inside the church tower. Now, while I'm writing, I'm consulting historical records, so what was written about the churches historically, also looking at the photographs and videos that were taken, the maps and the GIS data that we took during those excavations. And I'm looking at the notes, not only our field notes, which thankfully we had scanned to a PDF format so that they were easy for all of our staff to access remotely. And I'm looking at the notes that were written in the early 20th century by the women of the APVA who had previously dug the church. Most recently, I started writing about the different floor layers that we found in the chancel or the east end of the church. Now, we use the term floor here kind of loosely because really what we're talking about are just some small sections that survived of tiles or bricks all in one place. Or we may have just had a mortar bed in some instances that had different impressions from where tiles or brick was laid into the floor. Sometimes we even get joint lines from where two of the bricks or tiles met, but that's really all that we had to go on. Now, because we had these small sections and they were found here and there in different spots around the chancel, it was very hard for us to get a clear stratigraphic relationship between each of the floors and then also the burials that were located in the chancel. So when we're writing this report, we're hoping to figure out some of the sequencing of the floors and then assign phases to each of them and hopefully determine the period in which they were in use. Now, this is very challenging because a lot of these floors are cut by several different burials. And in this particular instance, there are just under 20 burials that were located in the chancel. And many of them are clustered together, so burials on top of burials. It's very common in the 17th century for wealthy individuals, colony leaders, and clergymen to be buried inside the church. And every time there was a burial placed inside the church, the brick or tile floor had to be removed. And then after the burial was filled in, you had to replace the floor over top of that. So we had lots of those different sections. To further complicate matters, in the early 20th century, the women of the APVA started excavation work in the church, and they investigated several of the burials, which meant that they removed some of the evidence of floor that did remain intact under the last floor that we see in all the photographs from 1901. Only one section of the original floor in the chancel survived, and it was only about 2 inches or so wide, this little small section of mortar bed, and it was cut on either side by a number of burials. We know that this was the earliest because in the profile we could see that it was sealing the original ground surface, so it was definitely the earliest floor. There were a few areas in the chancel where there were sections of floor that survived because they had slumped into graves as they settled. And instead of replacing that section of floor and pulling it up and removing it, When the parish redid the chancel floor, they simply filled in the section and covered over those tiles and then leveled the whole area before placing in the new chancel floor. There was one section that we had of tile work that had slumped down into a grave that had burned rubble sitting on top of the tile still adhered to it. And we know from the records that the church burns in 1676 during Bacon's Rebellion. So this particular section of floor was likely the floor that was in place when Bacon's Rebellion happens. And so that gives us kind of a date range as to the time period in which the grave underneath it was placed in the chancel, and also tells us that any of the graves that cut the floor with the burning still adhered to it were after Bacon's Rebellion. So we're getting some idea of the sequence of time from what we're seeing in the tile work and how they are related, how they relate to the graves in the chancel. Another thing that I've looked at while I'm at home is some of our recent mortar analysis that was completed by our team earlier this winter. During that project, the staff examined artifacts from the burial shaft fill, those in the chancel that we excavated, and compared the mortar samples in the fill to the mortar samples that were taken from the intact sections of chancel floors. So through this process, the team was able to identify and sort out which floor each of the burials cut based on the presence of certain mortars in the burial fill mixed in when the gravedigger cut through those floors while digging the grave. So I hope you've enjoyed this small glimpse into some of the discoveries that we've been making while we've been at home working on the reports. Report writing is really, really cool because it allows us to look back over our findings and refine some of our interpretations about those findings. Trying to assign dates and figure out the sequence of the floors and the burials in the chancel is like one giant logic puzzle. If this, then that. And it can be very time consuming. But it looks like with the way things are going lately that we've got some time. So we've just, from Jamestown Rediscovery, like to say hope everyone stays well and healthy out there. And we would like to say thank you to our healthcare workers on the front lines looking to get us back in service. And we hope to see all of you back at Jamestown very soon.